In the news this week, in an interview for the new film The Snowman with the Norwegian Broadcasting Corporation, director Tomas Alfredson said, "It happened very abruptly. Suddenly we got noticed that we had the money and could start the shoot in London. It's like when you're making a big jigsaw puzzle and a few pieces are missing so you don't see the whole picture." Link for the article in the show notes below. So if you're like me and you enjoy kind of like those crime, psychological thriller dramas, etc., you may have seen the previews for The Snowman and been like, ooh, this could be good. This could be good. Now, if you saw last week's episode, I talked about how the film's trailers and the marketing for it intrigued me enough that I was like, okay, this could work. But I didn't actually get out to see it. So The Snowman came out, and then all of a sudden, the day before the film, like, the embargo must have lifted, because all of a sudden it was like one Twitter headline after another about The Snowman. The Rotten Tomatoes score doesn't bode well for it. Like, it's just not doing well at all. So that turned me off immediately. I was like, well, I posted it on Twitter. I was like, I won't be seeing this film because I'm not going to spend my money on a film that's so across the board poorly received. It wasn't like a mix of it's kind of good, but it's not good. Like, across the board, it was just looked like everyone who had any insight on it was like, this film just does not work at all. So why would I spend my money on it? And why would I have you guys, or why would I encourage you to spend your money on it? It doesn't make sense, because we're looking at film and how to actually choose the films that might be worth our time and money on this show. So the article came out. So the interview that what we just talked about there in that last segment came out, and he said that there's he gave like an approximation of a percentage of less than 20%, but he said that that was the amount of the script that didn't get filmed. So there's this big chunk, almost a fifth of the story, that they didn't get to shoot. And that's why he was like, it just didn't work. Like, the film didn't work. So they rushed it. They didn't take their time with it. And they had this incredible cast in it and everybody working on it. You're just like, you're looking at the movie poster, right? And you're just like, wow, this movie is stacked with talent. And then they didn't shoot almost a fifth of the script. Like, it's nuts. So if you are curious about should you see The Snowman or not, I would encourage you, after this news article that is available below, along with all the other links and everything else for the show, all below in the description, so you can check that out. But I'd encourage you just to kind of stay away from this film unless it hits DVD and you're like, no, I really just want to see like how bad this film is. Like, how do you shoot a film that's missing, you know, that much of the story, that much of the script? Like, they made a movie, but they didn't even shoot the entire script. Like, it's just so weird. So if you're thinking about it, if you have any inclination at all and you are like, I totally should see this film, do us all a favor and Mystery Science Theater it, right? So in the link below, you can find some items for tech gear and stuff like that for making your own videos and your own online content. Check that out. And then post up those videos of you guys doing the Mystery Science Theater commentary over the film when you do watch it once it arrives on Blu-ray, and kind of give the world some more laughs there. Naomi Watts will be starring in the psychological thriller The Wolf Hour, which will have a Hitchcockian-style tension, according to an article by Variety. Link for the article in the show notes below. So you tell me you have a psychological thriller crime drama, you have my interest, right? My ears are up, I'm interested, give me your pitch, tell me your idea for this film, because anything that tickles the brain and makes me think when it comes to like drama and stuff like that, I'm intrigued by those movies. I may not see those movies, but I'm intrigued by those movies. When I heard this, I was like, oh, that's interesting. I wonder what like the time period is going to be. Modern? Is it going to go back? And it is going back to the time of Son of Sam in New York. So back in the 70s, right? And if you aren't familiar with Son of Sam, he is, as far as serial killers go, he's a famous one, right, in American history. So I wanted to do some research just real quick before this episode to make sure that I had the information so I could tell you it, because it's really kind of odd. Like, here's what happened. So there was several shootings that he did. I've got my notes here, so you have to bear with me. So there were several shootings that he did between the summer of 76 and 77, 1976 to 1977 in New York. And in August of 1977, the cops found him. Now, he claims this is where it gets really like, this guy was nuts. His neighbor Sam has a dog. The dog's name is Harvey. And apparently a demon. He didn't bother to tell us the demon's name, unfortunately. I feel like that would have made the story a little bit more intriguing. When you go out and you have conversations with dogs, I don't think we ever assume those dogs are possessed. So he's talking to possessed demon dog Harvey. And this dog tells him, okay, so we are going to need you, you know, to go out and kill a bunch of people. And he looks at demon-possessed dog Harvey and he goes, yeah, this makes sense. So he does it, right? So it's going to be, now you add that kind of bizarre, weird, like, what is wrong with you kind of atmosphere to a story with, you know, Naomi Watts, who's an incredibly talented actress. And I'm intrigued. I'd like to see a preview. If, you know, if you're the type of person that is into like those TV shows about serial killers and stuff like that, this is probably going to be right up your alley. I was really excited when they used the word Hitchcockian, because you tell me it's an Alfred Hitchcock movie on TV. I have, you know, Alfred Hitchcock Presents, the TV show I grew up on. And that was on Nick at Night. So I'd stay up late and watch those. Like, there's just a lot of good tension and layers in the story that you can use when you start looking at how Alfred Hitchcock made his films. So if you're in TV shows, so if you're going to use that kind of style in telling this bizarre story, you have my interest. I'm curious and I'm looking forward to seeing the first trailer, and I hope you guys are too. Sound off below. The UTA, the United Talent Agency, and the Jim Henson Company have signed a partnership that will expand Henson's feature and primetime television slate, virtual reality, gaming, and other digital initiatives. The company is currently in production on The Dark Crystal: Age of Resistance for Netflix. So if you're like me, you enjoy The Muppets, right? And I think a lot of people do. The Muppet movies have that resurgence. Like, I think everybody likes The Muppets. People still, myself included, love Kermit's version of The Rainbow Connection. There's still a lot of love for The Muppets. But what's the UTA? Like, why is them signing with the UTA a big deal? I did some research, right? My due diligence to bring you guys the news. And here's what the UTA is and who they've worked with and why this is important. So the UTA has been working with clients like Lauren Kasdan, Larry David, the Coen brothers, Steven Soderbergh, Johnny Depp, Vincent D'Onofrio, Joan Cusack. And then in 2007, they formed the United Entertainment Group, who worked with companies, big companies, right? Like Procter & Gamble, Nestle, Starbucks, Avon, The Pottery Barn, AT&T, Frito-Lay. And then in 2015, they started a music group with clients like Muse, Paramore, Kanye West, Mariah Carey, Chris Brown, DJ Khaled. So you have this gigantic media conglomerate that works with everybody who's from directing to acting to music to Fortune 500 companies, right? And now they're going to be working with The Muppets. And I don't see what's not to love about this news. After I was looking over like what they do and who they've worked with, I was like, this is phenomenal, because now we might be getting even more Muppets. Like, and they're talking about virtual reality, they're talking about gaming, stuff like that. That's cool if that's what you're into. But if you're like me and you're like, just give me some movies, give me some TV shows or some online content, right, that we can stream through either Amazon, Netflix, Hulu, whoever, this is great news for us, especially if you are a Muppets fan. Or if you're a parent of kids who love the Muppets, right? Because then you've got all this new Muppet content for your kids that's going to be coming. And we can rest assured that it's going to be top quality content, because that's the caliber of delivery, the high quality caliber of delivery that UTA brings. And we already know that we're getting high quality from Jim Henson Company. But I think we can get excited about the future of the Muppets and kind of what they're going to do, right? And because they don't do just the Muppets. They do puppetry and everything else and special effects for other movies and stuff like that. But it's going to be cool to see like what we get from the Jim Henson Company. Director Josh Boone announced that when he approached Fox, he had plans for a New Mutants horror trilogy. The New Mutants film is set to be released in theaters April of 2018. The link for the trailer is in the show notes below. Now, if you're like me and you've already seen the trailer, you may have been caught off guard. Whether you were pleasantly surprised or confused, perplexed or happy, I was caught off because I was like, wait, is this X-Men? Because this looks like a Cure for Wellness meets like something else. Clearly, the story captured the attention of Fox and the director Josh Boone, who wanted to present this. But the fact that he came out and said, look, I want to do this as a trilogy, that has me concerned. And here's why I'm concerned that he initially set out to do a trilogy. He didn't come into Fox and be like, I just want to make a movie. He came into like, okay, guys, girls, whatever, I have got an idea for three pictures based around X-Men's The New Mutants, and here's my pitch. And so for me, when I hear that, I go, well, we don't even know if this first one's going to be good. Like, we don't even know if the public is going to widely accept, probably PG-13, right? Probably, if it's X-Men, a PG-13 asylum horror movie with mutants and their powers. We don't know how it's going to be received. It's not just like, I want to make a movie and I'm going to tell the story and then we're done. And then, oh my goodness, look how widely accepted it was. Look how much money this film made. Let's make more. Thank goodness I had the foresight to have ideas written down for movies 2 and 3. That's not what's happening. He's like, I'm going to tell 3 movies. If people go out like you and me and we see this film and we're like, ugh. Well, we just got part of a story. That's why I'm concerned. We just got part of a story because we know from what he just said, it's three films. The story is going to unfold in 3 films. That's his idea, right? I'm like, well, now we have to hope the first one's good, because if the first one's not good, we don't get the rest of the story. We're just left with like this, like, weird, like, well, that was different kind of film. And where do we go from there? Like, we don't get the resolution of the story. There's no resolution on the conflict, right? Part of the story may resolve, but if it's a 3-movie story arc, we're only going to get that first third. So we're only going to get to experience approximately 33% of the film, or 33% of the story in one film. And it's like, ooh, I don't know. Like, can't you tell us the story? And then if more develops, then cool, it develops. But like, let's get one under the belt and let's see if people like it. Like, outside of the first Blade movie, I can't really think of like a mutant or Marvel film that's been horror-esque, really, that's been like super successful. The first Blade was really good. Second one, not so much. The third one was kind of just popcorn fun. Well, the first and the second, people go back and forth because the second one was Guillermo del Toro. There's not been a big outcry, right? There's a big outcry for horror because horror movies, as we'll discuss later with, you know, what came out in theaters this weekend that made money, you'll see, again, we have horror movies really doing well right now. But that could just be because we're coming off of how well and how successful it was. And also, we're in Halloween, so people are more, they're kind of predisposed to Halloween and horror movies right now in this time of year. So we can't really say with 100% certainty, I feel, that horror movies are doing great because the horror movies themselves are great, or if people are just predisposed to be excited about horror movies because of the time of year we're in, and because they're still running the high of It. So I have to see. This is like, I heard this news and I was like, oh, that's weird. Like, I don't know if I can be excited now, because if the first movie's not good, if New Mutants isn't good, I hope it's good, because I don't want to go see a movie that sucks. But I hope it's good, because then I can get the rest of the story. But if it's not good, they're probably not going to make 2 and 3, which means we aren't going to get the full story that Boone had in his head when he sat down to make the first film. Sound off below if you disagree. The honorable mentions this week: Lionsgate and Dubai Parks and Resorts have announced the grand opening of the brand new Hunger Games theme park at Motion Gate Dubai, the Middle East's largest inspired theme park. Nicolas Cage is currently fighting a Japanese corn snack that has his picture and name on it. Justice League dropped a new movie poster. Netflix finally announced that The Punisher will be available for streaming and or binge watching November 17th on Netflix. Marvel Studios President Kevin Feige says a female Thor in the Marvel Cinematic Universe is a possibility. All right, and that is it for the news this week. As always, if anything popped off in the news that you saw and you were like, this was super dope, why didn't you talk about it? Sound off below in the comments, and we can keep the conversation going all week long until next week's episode.